All right, my friends, welcome to episode 206 of Prof and Dev Play Games. He is the dev at SummerSpeak on Twitter, and I am the professor at Prof Plays Games. I'm switching it up, going with you first. That almost fucking tripped me up. That's crazy. How you doing, man?
I'm doing good. I am full of peach cobbler.
Oh, God, that sounds good.
Yeah, it's peach season up here. I love it.
Let's forego the games talk and talk about cobblers.
Cobblers?
Top five cobblers. Go.
Five? Well, this peach is definitely top. It's just a ton of butter. Yeah, God, sounds good. It's so good. Then
what's the butter to peach ratio? 1-to-1?
Almost. You would think so. It seems like it. You just, when you're making, you're like, this is so much butter. Like, this is not good for me, but whatever. It tastes amazing.
That sounds great.
I don't know. Top five. Blackberry. I'm a big fan of blackberry cobbler after that. Actually, is there a cobbler I don't like? I think it really just comes up to the fruit itself. I'm okay
strawberry, rhubarb, cherry.
Not cherry. I'm fine with cherries. I'm just not a huge fan of cherries.
Oh, really? Interesting.
No. Rainier cherries I love, but like Bing cherries and stuff, no. I've had a good apple cobbler before. Yeah, but top two really are just peach and either a blackberry or a marionberry.
Nice. Yeah, I think for me it's peach and then cherry in that order. Peach is, we agree, is the best. It cobbler of the year from Prof and Dev Play Games.
There you go. Everyone should just go out and make cobblers because it's so good.
Oh my God. But we're talking about more than cobblers this week. We're talking about Gamescom because it actually happened.
It did happen.
Although it seems like it happened a while ago, but it was just this last week. So we're going to talk about some of the news that came out of that. Maybe a little bit about GameStop and Game Informer, and then talk about what we are playing. So why don't we start with Gamescom? There's lots of stuff that came out of Gamescom from Germany, but kind of what stuck with you as some big news?
The Death Stranding gameplay.
Oh, geez.
It's literally a walking simulator.
That's what everyone who played, like, actually in the booth or whatever, they're like, it's a walking simulator.
It is more walking simulator than anything that's ever been called a walking simulator. Because the whole point of the game is you start in the East Coast at DC and you're trying to go to the West Coast.
By walking across, making connections.
I mean, they've shown that you get vehicles and stuff like that. And you're trying to, like, do quests, and you have a backpack of different things that you're delivering along the way. Like, you really are just like a glorified delivery person,
right?
Like, all the jokes are true. I mean, that's the underlying core gameplay of it, is walk across the U.S. reconnecting civilization.
All those weird trailers and whatever sneak peeks at the game that people were seeing that, but then saying, oh, there's got to be more to it, this, that, and the other. And then when they got their hands on it in the booth, they're like, that's it. And I think people are still excited about it.
I think there's more to it still.
Okay.
But I think you have to say that the core of the game, that is your goal in the game at base level. You are crossing. How does that work when you're switching into, like, the BTs and the other World War I-esque type thing? Like,
right.
I'm sure there's still a pretty big twist going on here, and I doubt it's going to be anyone's going to get to play it publicly until it's released to really see what that is. And I'm sure it will leak, most likely, but the base concept of the game is just walking and taking a leak, because that's amazing. The character model moves as you try to move the camera around, so you cannot see his penis.
Oh, man. Okay, I'm not going to play that game then.
I'm just like, oh, this is
unrealistic.
This is ridiculous. I mean, more hilarious. Power to you, Kojima, that you get to make this game.
I wonder if that happened during mocap, where Norman Reedus just kept moving. He's like, hey, Kojima, stop.
I mean, what else did they show? They showed a couple things. Like, I was amazed how much they showed of it here.
Yeah.
Because they showed, like, a 6-minute gameplay, which was the, like, delivering a thing and finishing a quest to Jeff Keighley, voiced by Matt Mercer.
So, wait. I didn't realize Keighley was voiced by Matt Mercer?
Uh-huh.
What? Why isn't Keighley doing his own voice?
He just isn't doing his own voice. He was just there. He was used. He was clearly 3D scanned to be as a character in the game, but not doing the voice acting for that character.
Right. It's hard for me now. Like, Keighley's always been just a huge hype man for Kojima, but now that he's in the game, it just feels a little too close.
Like, sounds like a lot of people are got scanned for this game. Like Twitter was going through and like reposting things of like the director Edgar Wright had a picture on Twitter that he was there and had gotten scanned like 6 months ago.
Oh wow. So he's just throwing everyone in.
I have a feeling like he's just like, come on down, anyone that is a friend of mine or wants to be in this that's an actor in Hollywood, come on, let's do it. Get scanned, get in my game.
I'm no longer with Konami. The chains are unhooked, whatever.
Uh-huh.
Everything that I want to do, I can do. So come on down.
Yeah, pretty much.
Crazy.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm just not – I think it's because I'm not that huge of a fan of Kojima in that I haven't played many of his games. Not that they're not great. That I just – still not caring much about this big fall game, this big tentpole release, you know?
It is a tentpole. I'm sure it's going to sell like crazy.
Oh, of course. Overall. Of course. I mean, other games have sold a ton that I haven't purchased, so it's fine. Okay, so Death Stranding, what else pops out from Gamescom?
What else popped out? There was all that Nintendo stuff.
Indies. Showcase.
Yeah, it was just an indie showcase, mostly worldwide stuff, so it wasn't really U.S. at all.
Right. There's the big thing at the end was Ori and the Blind Forest Definitive Edition coming to Switch. Yeah, it seemed like a natural fit, and it's a great game, so which I need to get back and beat. I'm on the last level, and it's fucking torture.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, it's coming out on 27th. There was one game that I never heard of, Eastward. Maybe you've heard of that game.
Uh-uh, I hadn't heard of it at all either.
It looked great. It looked really – it's like a RPG.
Yeah, it's Chucklefish.
Yeah.
Or publishing, at least.
Yeah, I wonder, are they publishing or are they actually developing it?
It's so hard because they do both.
Yeah, so right.
They might actually – this might be one internal to them. I don't know, though. I have to check again. But yeah, it looks cool. It has that Chucklefish style. So
yeah. Yeah, it looks really, really interesting. It's a 2020 release. And then they, I think it had leaked before, but Superhot was coming to Switch, which has already come out.
Yep.
So gyro aiming looks pretty cool.
Yeah, Superhot came out. Hotline Miami Collection came out.
Yep. And then got pulled from Australia.
Of course it did.
Got released there.
Yeah. Oops. What else was like Shadow released at that time?
Oh, there are a couple more games. Looking at the list here, none of them are popping up in my head that they're releasing then. Torchlight 2 came out or is coming out pretty quickly.
Yeah.
What else was coming out? There's a couple other games that came out during that direct, but I can't.
Yeah.
Looking at the games on this list, none of them pop out as things that I remember.
Yeah, I do think with Torchlight 2, it's so weird to see that game continuing since Runic is no more the developers of that game. So the IP fell to back to the part owner of it, which was Perfect World. And they're just running with that game. Just be like, fine, we're going to put it wherever. It's an okay action RPG overall. The Torchlight ones have never been super deep, but they're well crafted for what they are. But I mean, I already have Diablo 3 and then I find Diablo 3 just better than Torchlight 2. So,
and that new season just started.
It did. Another thing, which I don't have time to play.
Yeah. No, I feel you. A couple other things on this list. Cat Quest 2, I thought looked really good.
Yeah.
And What the Golf.
What the Golf, I saw at PAX last year.
Nice. What did you think of it?
It was hilarious.
Yeah.
I'm golfing a house. The ball is a house. And it's just dumb. It's completely dumb. It's definitely one of those things that I feel like this would be... will make a great party game.
Right.
Like just to pass the controller around or doing a, who can get the best stroke count on it.
Like who can make other people laugh the most.
Yeah. It's going to be hilarious. It's hilarious the entire time.
Yeah. Well, it's still, a ways off. It's 2020, I think.
Yeah. So. And, the other one I saw at PAX last year was, Fogs. And I played that with my son in the booth.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, it's, this was on a PS4, whatever machine it was on was behind a screen. You couldn't see it, but I was using a PS4 controller.
Yeah.
But it was, you can play it with one controller with two people and each person controls a head of this connected fog.
Oh, that dog thingy.
Yeah.
It's like a wiener dog with no butt.
Yeah, with two heads.
Yeah.
It seemed fun. It seemed like it would be a really fun co-op game.
Yeah, really silly. Good one to play with kids for sure.
Yeah, definitely. My son totally got it. It was great. And it totally works if you're going to be playing with two Joy-Cons. There you go.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
I
was surprised how many games were released, they were announced as releasing 2020.
Yeah.
because, I don't know, maybe the back, I don't quite remember how many Switch games are coming out this year. From now until the end, it's going to be Luigi's Mansion, Pokemon,
Link's Awakening,
Link's Dragon Awakening
Quest.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I was thinking first party, but yeah.
Yeah. There's a number of big things on the way out there.
They probably don't need to pad out the rest of the
Witcher 3. There's one that got announced.
October 15th, man. Yep. I fucking pre-ordered that game for sure, physical, because there's so many goodies coming with that. This is, let's see, I bought it for Xbox, I bought it for PS4, I bought it for PC, and now I'm going to buy it for Switch.
There you go.
Fuck.
What are the goodies?
It's like a map. I think the soundtrack, there's some sort of, what the fuck else is in there? A couple other things. Poster, maybe? Wow. I should know this. Let me look it up while you keep talking. Vamp for me, man.
I called it Final Fantasy VIII got announced, release date got announced or something.
Oh, that's right.
September 3rd.
That's really close.
Yeah.
A couple stickers, a map, Witcher 3 compendium.
Oh.
And then a nasty tasting Switch cart.
Of course.
So, yeah, that's what there is. Looking forward to it.
Wow. They're doing $60 for it too.
They are. Yeah.
Wow.
Well, you know, if you think about it in terms of base game plus the two DLCs, $20 each.
That's not how much they cost at all.
I know, but it makes it easier for me to swallow buying it the fourth time.
I can get the complete edition on PC. What? Actually, I saw it for $20 last week, 2 weeks ago. It was on sale.
Yeah, it's regularly on sale for that.
And I got it on the... I had it on PC. I bought it on PS4 for $25 6 months ago.
But you can't play your PC while you're driving your car.
I can't. I'm more just like...
And you also shouldn't do that with your Switch.
60, guys. 60.
Yeah. The CD Projekt Red guys said... let's see. What's this headline here? The founder says building the Switch port for Witcher 3 helped them understand the console, understand the Switch. And they said, well, what does that mean for your future games coming out on the Switch? And they said, I don't know how that affects our future plans. Future plans.
I have a hard time seeing Cyberpunk hitting this.
Oh, fuck no. No.
But I
maybe
can see them.
I'm hoping Thronebreaker. Or
Thronebreaker I could totally see making it.
Yeah. I think I might hold on to that until maybe it comes to Switch. I keep meaning to buy it on console or PC and I just don't get around to it.
I guess they'll probably see how well this does.
Yeah. Well, they've got my vote.
And they'll make a choice on if they want to keep pursuing porting things over.
Yeah. The hands-on with it, a lot of, you know, people are talking about how the graphics are a little bit but overall plays pretty well. So
yeah, I mean, they focused on getting it playable. Was Digital Foundry's thing. The frame rate was fine. Up close tended to be fine, but it did a lot of dynamic resolution stuff.
Mm-mm.
So lots of the draw distance and where it got blurry was pretty close at times.
Right.
But they said that there was like a 15-minute Digital Foundry on it, the hands-on, and they had save games at like in Novigrad, like in the city, or what is
right.
it? And they had it save in the swamps, like mm-hmm. all these places that are notoriously very bad performance. So clearly they're like, Digital Foundry's like, they're trying to show off, like, hey, it runs
the
even in
parts.
Like the hardest, worst parts of the game. And it did, and they're like, And Digital Foundry wasn't like negative at the end. They were like, they were impressed that this was even done, but they're like, don't come into it thinking this is going to win any kind of visual awards here. Like if you want that game actually looking like particularly good, they're like, play it on another console.
Right.
But if you want to play it on the go, play it here and you can play it.
And that's how I feel pretty good about this because I've already played it on PC and PS4 and Xbox One. So I have played a great version of it in terms of visual fidelity, so I know the sacrifice and I'm fine because I want to play it on the go. Everything about the price, maybe this adds into it. It's the first game in the West to be released on a 32 gigabyte cart, which those carts are pretty expensive,
probably.
So it's nice that there are no downloads, it's just all there.
Yeah. Oh, I totally agree.
So I just upgraded my SD card, so I got a 256 in there now.
Oh, wow.
And re-download a bunch of my games, and I only have 80 gigs left, so a 32 gig game would eat that up, so it's nice to have it on the cart.
Wow.
I wonder, I think what I read though about the load times is, even though it's on the cart, the load
the
times
same.
Are still
they're the same. They're like maybe five to 10 seconds longer.
Yeah,
which Digital Foundry's like, that was the thing, they're like, they're comparable, but the thing is everything is, it's like lower quality textures and everything.
Yep.
So it's while it's comparable, it's loading less data than the PS4 version. Like, that's the trade. That's how they could get it lower. Because
yeah, looking at the screenshots with that, the different textures and things, it's quite noticeable, but still, I feel like I'm not going to care that much.
Yeah, it's playable. It'll be
fun. Yeah, I know what I'm getting to. I'm very excited. Super, super excited. Are you, I assume you're not double dipping
not,
on that one.
Not yet.
Yeah.
That would be one that maybe when there's a sale. Like, I would probably, I would probably do like 30 or 40 for it.
Right.
There's so much other stuff coming out that I
God, I know. It's an, of course, as always, an embarrassment of riches.
Yeah.
And I was pretty interested in the Xbox, Inside Xbox, they did their announcement, and most stuff, not so much, but some of their Xbox Game Pass announcements were pretty cool. I'm surprised that Devil May Cry 5 is already in there. That came out this year.
It did.
And it's already in Game Pass. I don't know what that means about how well it did, but it's a game that I've been interested in playing because Brad was talking a lot about it, but now I can just get a month of Game Pass and play it. So that's pretty cool.
That is true.
Especially as Gears 5 is coming out, I need to finish the last chapter of Gears 4 and move into Gears 5. So I think purchasing it for September would kind of net me all three of those games at one go.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think that's fine. I mean, I don't know how well it's did or didn't do. I don't know how the company, how that pays a publisher anyway, developer. Like, if they in Game Pass, how do they get paid?
I don't know. The developers, at least the smaller ones, keep talking about how it's just paying dividends for them to be in Game Pass because they're making way more sales than they would have otherwise. And someone was breaking it down and saying it's basically just advertisement. We're always on the dashboard. People always see our game. So,
yeah,
I don't know. But that big of a game, maybe they get extra money. I have no clue.
Yeah.
One thing we didn't talk about with Cyberpunk 2077 is that it's coming for Google Stadia.
Yep.
I don't know if that floats your boat or not, but I guess Borderlands 3, Cyberpunk, Elder Scrolls Online.
I mean, I expected stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, it's not exclusives to Stadia. It's just big games that you can play on Stadia. But I have a nice big collector's edition of Cyberpunk coming. So
nice.
I will enjoy that.
Yeah. Keep that physical edition.
Yeah, pretty much. Physical edition on PS4, and then I'll probably buy a PC version.
Right, because are you going to play mainly on PC?
I don't know right now. It depends on where I'm at in my house at that point. Mm-hmm. Like, with my PC right now downstairs is, like, in my office. I don't tend to come down to it at night to play anything.
That's why you've been there all day.
Yeah, pretty much. And that's also why the Switch is so good, because I can just, like, I just kind of lay on the couch in the dark and play Switch.
Yep. Sounds weird. It's the dream, man. Lay down on your couch and play some Witcher 3 on your Switch.
Ugh. Yeah. Final Fantasy 8 on my Switch.
Which
will be playing Triple Triad, honestly.
It is a Triple Triad
simulator. It's really all it is for me, more than anything. My wife will probably play through 8, though. She's always been interested in it. So she wants to play it, wants to see Squall, the character modeled after a gacked Japanese J-rocker that she always liked. So yeah, I'm sure she'll at least give it a shot.
Yeah.
What else did I see? Anything else out of Gamescom that really
some of the awards were interesting?
I didn't even see a lot of those.
Well, so I'll read through a couple of them. I'll save one for the end because I have a question about it. Action game was Doom Eternal. Family game Concrete Genie, which I'm pretty excited about. Role-playing game Wasteland 3. Strategy Desperados 3. Winner of most original game Dreams. Best Xbox game.
I did see that. Yeah.
Gears 5. Nintendo game Link's Awakening. Best PS4 game Dreams. Best mobile game Battle Chasers Night War, which is interesting. That was a pretty good game on Switch.
Wow.
And then one question I have here for you, there's a game called, or the category called Best Action Adventure Game. Okay. Third place was Link's Awakening. Second place was Concrete Genie. And the first game, the winner of this was called Black Sad Under the Skin. Have you ever heard of that game?
No.
It's so the cover art here is basically a panther, it looks like, dressed in like a suit and tie and a jacket. It's a dark corruption scandal in the heart of New York City's underworld for charismatic detective John Blacksad. He's a fucking panther.
Oh, it's based on a comic.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah, it's based on a French comic.
Oh, shit. Okay, I've never heard of this.
Dark Horse In 2010, Dark Horse Comics published all three translated volumes in North America.
Huh. And this is one out over
one Eisner Awards.
Uh-huh.
Supposedly it looks like it's a pretty well-received comic. Why did it win over all that?
Yeah, that makes me sit up a little bit and say, huh? What is
Eisner
this game?
Winning Spanish comic series. Sorry, not French. Spanish comic series.
Okay.
Is it a Black Sabbath?
It releases November 5th.
Wow.
Best adventure game from Gamescom.
So it's adventure game.
1950s New York. Investigative narrative game with gameplay combining investigations, puzzles, quick time events, and multiple choice dialogue.
It's cool. Been compared to the work of Telltale.
Oh, fuck.
As well as L.A. Noire.
Hmm. I'm going to have to add that to my...
That's crazy.
Yeah, add that to my wish list. Interesting.
It's coming to Switch.
Good. It's coming to Switch?
Platforms, Windows, Mac OS, Nintendo Switch, PS4, Xbox One.
Well, all right. Because in that category, Link's Awakening I'm getting, Concrete Genie I'm getting, so maybe I'll add this to my list too. That's a surprise. Looks good.
Yeah.
So yeah, those are mainly the awards. Most things that were not surprised, but that one was a surprise for me.
And the transition to something you won't be getting anymore, Game Informer.
Is that accurate?
I don't know if it's actually going to stop or not, but whenever you half of your staff...
Yeah.
You are not ramping up to keep things going.
Yeah, and I subscribe to Game Informer, so I was wondering how that's going to play out. But basically, the parent company, GameStop, slashed like 100 people from its HQ in Texas and then cut half the editorial staff of Game Informer, which is a podcast that I fucking love, and I love the magazine. But, man, seems like it's going down.
Yeah.
That's sad, because a lot of good people got axed.
Yeah, totally. It's... I mean, the writing's been on the wall for GameStop for a while.
Yeah.
Overall. I was looking at more the data there. Yes, it's as things have gone more digital, they're selling less physical copies. But the thing is, with less physical copies, where they make most of their money on used games, that market's going away.
Right, because there are no physical games, or fewer physical games.
Like, it's like a double hit against them. It's less big, like, people just buying the games new to begin with from them.
Right.
And then because that happens, they don't have them to sell back to them so they can sell used copies.
Right.
It's like it is a very painful place for them to be. And it's not going to get better. I'll be honest.
No. Was it this year, last year, that digital overtook physical for the first time on console? So, yeah, they've been trying to diversify, I suppose, in terms of like having ThinkGeek stuff in the store, where like half the stuff in the store is not even games.
Make it nerdy, geeky things.
Yeah, exactly. But man, the Game Informer thing is what makes you sad.
It is sad, and it's likely gonna die.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of print publications have been. Yeah. If they go all digital, I don't know if that will help them at all, but
it could maybe. It's also super competitive digitally right now.
True.
Like,
yeah,
they would have to be fighting against Kotaku and IGN and Polygon and GameSpot. Like, those are kind of like your big ones,
right?
And that's pretty hard to probably make good revenue there. I mean, people have broken it down on like those sites. It's hard to make revenue,
right?
Keep viewership. So I don't know. I feel bad for them. I watched a video a couple nights ago that was like the history of that company, and it just brought back memories of what was it in the Eureka Mall and Bayshore Mall. It was Software Etc.
Yep.
Which wasn't like, there was two companies. There was Babbage's was the first company, and then they merged with Software Etc. But they kept the names separate, but they were the same company.
Right.
Back in like the '80s.
Then there was like Electronics Boutique or EP
was the
Games.
third thing that they bought, and they rebranded all those GameStops. And then by like mid-2000s, they just rebranded the whole thing GameStop. But yeah, it was like this. But the thing is, Software Etc., or maybe it was Babbage's, was the first one. Yeah, it started as Babbage's was the main thing, and they went through the original game crash in the '80s. And basically, Nintendo saved their company's ass because the NES came out.
Oh, okay.
The original NES came out, and like, because you look at their, it was showing like their financial stuff. Like, they crashed hard as the video game industry crashed in the early '80s. and they barely stayed afloat, and they just happened to survive long enough for the NES to come out.
I guess people are talking about that now in terms of the next, 2020 for the next console cycle, and giving that some sort of like lifeblood to temporary, at least to GameStop. But I wonder if that's going to be enough at all.
Some, I'm sure. Yeah, I mean, it's going to help some, but I don't know how many people get their consoles from GameStop is the thing.
Right. Yeah.
I think they also have to compete a lot more, with right? Amazon and Best Buy and Target and Walmart. Like, people just go. You used to couldn't go to those stores typically to get these things. Like, you wanted to go to GameStop because that's the place that had a lot of this when it was a more of a niche hobby.
Right.
But now it's mainstream. So all the mainstream big box stores have everything. So I don't know. Their days are numbered.
Yes, for sure. And unfortunately, that means the publication's days are numbered.
Yeah.
Because I don't know. I don't see someone buying them out. But
oh, fun fact. Person who invested it back in the 80s, that got it off the ground and helped. Ross Perot.
What?
Ross Game Perot was the person that got off Babbage's back in the day.
Oh, Babbage's. Okay.
Yeah, but like, he was the initial investor of these two guys that graduated college that were like, hey, we want to start up a business selling PC and console games.
Right. And probably less than interested in the content.
It took him like a year to
return.
To get funding. But Ross Perot was the one who funded them. I'm just like, crazy. That is so weird.
Weird shit every day, man.
Yeah, pretty much.
Speaking of weird shit. Oh, before we get into what we're playing, happy 10-year anniversary to Arkham Asylum.
I saw that.
Fuck, that game was great.
The first one I loved. I love that one so much. Yep.
That's funny. I played the first one and the third one, but not the second one. I should probably
I think they just that. I still like the first one the most. I played the second one some, and I just could basically felt the second one's just it's all the stuff that was in the first game, just more, and I don't think just more was better.
Right.
Like, there was something very, very tight about that initial Arkham Asylum.
Oh yeah, I felt like there was like no wasted space at all.
Exactly, and that was
such a perfect
game. Pacing.
Yep.
You get through it, and I'm like, that was great. Yep. And then the other ones, they expanded to be much more open world and have things to collect and find. And I don't know, it kills the pace of the game. Like, I'm in there, I want to see a Batman story. Like, just throw it at me. Let's do this.
Yep.
So that first one though, I was so taken back by that game. I was unprepared for how good that was going to be.
Yeah, it'd be nice to see Rocksteady kind of focus again. Because I don't know if you played through Arkham Knight, but the tank stuff and I know that some people love those Riddler trophies, but just how much bloat there was just like you said, just ground the pace down to nothing.
It really did.
Oh, man. So anyway, happy anniversary to them. And speaking of games, what are you playing?
I've been playing Fire Emblem still. Mm-hmm. Progressing through that. Haven't hit the time jump yet, but getting close.
How's that how's the Yellow Deer track treating you?
It is different. Like, you're getting different lore.
Yeah.
So I don't want to spoil it for you because it's
thank you.
Definitely giving me a different perspective on a lot of the, I guess, not really spoilers. There's like the special weapons in the game.
Yeah.
The relic weapons and the crests and kind of how they are connected more. Like, you don't get a lot of that out of the Black Eagle, but the Golden Deer are starting to talk a lot more about like, well, why are these connected? What's going on? Like, where's the information about this? We don't have it. Let's see what we can find. So it's neat getting that perspective and that information about more of the world. So yeah, I've played a bit of that. This week has been not a ton of gaming. It's been a lot of work. But then I also spent some time playing Dragon Quest XI demo and being taken back to my childhood.
You started with the Dragon Quest games, right?
Yeah, I mean, so here's going to be the crazy thing. I never owned, Dragon Warrior back on the NES.
Right.
I borrowed it from Dan Davis.
What?
He had it. He would love JRPGs back in like that. But I remember we would sit in his house or my house when he brought it over and fumble around with that game because holy shit, did JRPGs not tell you what to do back in, you know, the late 80s, early mid to late 80s.
Right.
Like, you're like, I don't know. I'm just gonna leave the castle and fight some slimes. We did beat it, though, I'm pretty sure. I just don't remember exactly. But I just remember it was a lot of wandering around, not knowing exactly what we needed to do.
All right. That sounds about right.
But man, I was shocking like playing 11, and they still have some of the same sound effects thrown in.
Well, and I haven't played any of the Dragon Quest games or Dragon Warrior games before this one. But, you know, obviously the symphonic soundtrack versus those little kind of chiptune-y sound effects. I was like, are they... This must be nostalgic for people who played the early games. I'm glad they did it because it, I mean, it probably adds to the atmosphere, but it was nice.
Yeah. I'm only like an hour and a half into it.
Yeah. I just climbed the top of the tour.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I just came back down actually. So
I'm past, I mean, I did all that, got my next quest and just arrived at the main city. Not the little town, but went to the main city was the next piece. But I haven't done anything in that main city. I mean, it's classic JRPG just through and through. But there's a charm to it, I guess, is the way I'm talking about. Like, I'm playing it and I'm like, this is just, at least at face value at the beginning, back to the basics JRPG.
And is that in terms of just like straightforward narrative?
Very straightforward narrative.
You're a I think it's less open world, right?
Kind of the chosen one. Yeah, there's not huge open world. Like, there's maps, the old transition through, that you can wander around those maps and fight things as you wish. I mean, all the fights are you either engaging them or running from them, like, on the main map. Like, you don't have to fight if you don't want to. Especially if you're on a horse, you can just gallop through everything and not fight a thing. But yeah, it's just mostly the presentation of just being like, let's just present this as a simple, you are some special one and you need to figure out what that means and where you're going. I'm pretty sure it's probably going to have some bigger twist later on. But for now, it's just simple and straightforward. And it looks great on the Switch, I'll be honest.
It does. I thought the thing that stands out for me is the background and the character models. Like, art style is just a little bit off, so it's like I can really see like the foreground backgrounding of those two. I don't know what the models, the artifacts or whatever.
Yeah.
So that throws it out for me a little bit. I'm like, oh, okay, those are separate things. They're not really existing in the same space. But other than that, it runs well. It looks good. So.
Yeah, it's been pretty fun playing that.
Yeah, no frame rate drops that I've noticed. No. Nothing chugging so far. I like how it just kind of, I mean, it's basically the climbing up the tour, going through that little cave there. It's just like the tutorial, learning how to fight and, you know, get your spell or whatever. But have you picked up other party members?
Not yet. Okay. Now I have no party members.
No. Oh,
like, it's just me.
So your view is gone.
I assume that I'll be getting one soon.
Right.
Because I've heard there's a fair amount of party members in the game. So, yeah, I'm waiting. I'm waiting to pick up one of those. Another friend up here that I have talked to about it said that he loved it. He finished it. Said it took about 80 hours, and it was a blast. And there's a ton of different skill trees to go down and, like, builds for your character, which I haven't seen any of that yet. So,
holy shit. Sorry. Something just popped up in my newsfeed. Where my wife used to live. Like, fucking right next to her house is fucking burning right now down in L.A.
Oh,
holy shit. Sorry.
Glendale area?
Yeah. Yep. Oh, my God. Okay. Sorry. That just had Twitter on and just popped up in the corner. Said Glendale fire is trending. I was like, wait, what? Fuck.
Isn't L.A. always burning at some place somewhere?
Yes, it is true. But I hope people are safe.
Safe. Yes.
So yeah, this week I've been playing Dragon Quest XI as well, just the demo, which is pretty cool because I did the vouchers, so I had 4 vouchers and I was going to buy this game for sure. And then when it came up for pre-order, I was able to buy it. But then the demo came out and it said you can play, it's like a 10-hour demo basically, and then you just transfer your save over. So there's no way in hell I'm going to play 10 hours of that game before it comes out because I'm so freaking busy right now. So I get to play it a month early basically, which is kind of nice. Does that demo entice you to buy the full game?
Yes.
On release, you're going to wait?
We'll see.
Yeah.
Because Link's Awakening comes out a week early.
I know.
I'm just like, oh, guys. This is a lot. This is a lot in 2 weeks period
Right.
there.
Right.
And then I have PAX this coming up weekend. So
yeah, that's going to be a lot of fun.
It's going to be a lot of fun, but I'm like, look at my wallet and my budget and go, uh-huh. Oh, okay. Yeah. Cause let's be honest, I will buy things at PAX. That's going to,
yes.
that will happen. So
speaking of, if you happen to see Gary Whitta anywhere on the floor, just walk up to him and ask for a Space Rocks pin.
Okay.
He's giving, he made 100 and he's giving away 100 to anyone who walks up to him and asks him for it. So, I'm curious.
I have to see him on the floor.
See him somewhere. It doesn't matter. But if you happen to see him, which you probably won't because it's such a big floor, but who knows? Just in case.
I wonder how well he can just walk around
mm-hmm.
and not get mobbed.
Right.
Like, he's known. The name is known, but I don't think how he looks is known. It's like when the actual, like, Gabe and Tycho from Penny Arcade walk around PAX. Most people don't even notice them.
Right.
Like, they can walk that entire floor and just peruse and maybe get a dozen people asking for a picture over the entire thing. Me being one of them 1 year. But
yeah.
But still, like, you're like, yep, they can wander around and not be bugged. So I bet he can get away with it a bit.
Yeah, that's why I'm wondering that you might actually, if you do see him, might be able to get one.
Yeah.
Not a big deal, but just in case.
Space Rocks.
It's fucking stupid. This basically on the Kind of Funny Games Daily podcast, he was talking about they were pitching some sort of board game. And he's just like something that's so stupid that you should never play. And he's basically just like Space Rocks. It's a game where you just have rocks and I think you like hit each other in the head with them or like throw them at people or throw them at things. I don't know. It was very dumb. But then he created fucking like 100 copies of the board game and 100 pins to sell the board games and then give out the pins at PAX this year. So it's a very long, stupid thing.
Okay. But if I see him, I will ask for one.
Awesome. Thanks. Appreciate it.
I likely won't see him, but I'm
sure you won't.
He's doing the keynote for it.
Yeah, he is. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sure the pins will be out gone at the keynote, basically.
Yeah. If someone can get up. It's interesting how they're doing because I think the main stage is the Paramount Theater next door, which is a big music venue and like musicals and plays are there. So,
right.
There's not really great act. Like, the stage is actually a stage.
Right.
So it's not like people can just swarm him at the stage. So we'll see. I hope to be going to the Supergiant concert there.
Yeah, that's going to be awesome. And actually, the Supergiant leads me into our Patreon questions for the month.
Oh, okay.
Our Patreon supporter, Brad, who I talk about quite a bit, he asked a question about video game soundtracks. Maybe if you could think about your top three. And I'll go while you're thinking.
Where's my notebook? I had these written down at one point. I did because I talked about them.
Right. And the reason why I segue into this, because my number one soundtrack of all time is Transistor, simply because it's the one that I listen to the most.
Transistor is in my top three.
Yeah. That's so
Final Fantasy good. Tactics is in there.
Nice.
My
number two would be Witcher 3, just in terms of how many times I listen to it. Like when I'm with my daughter playing in the living room or whatever, I'll put on Transistor, I'll put on the Witcher 3 soundtrack. And when Transistor's playing, my wife comes home, she's like, oh, that sounds good. When she comes home and Witcher 3 is playing, she's like, what the fuck is this? Turn this off. So
yeah.
Fun.
No, I can't say one single game. I'm just going to say Mass Effect Trilogy.
Nice.
Actually, I will say the first game. I love the soundtrack of the first game. Very Tangerine Dream-esque sound. Like, I absolutely love it. Like, that was one of their big influences, was Vangelis and Tangerine Dream, and it shows, and I love it. And
I will love just Tangerine Dream. That's great.
Put that music on and just kind of just immerse myself in just the, I don't know, it just transports you to a different place.
Right.
So, yeah, I can. So, Transistor is probably my top as well. I love that music. I think that's Darren Korb's best. And then probably Mass Effect 1 and then Final Fantasy Tactics.
Yeah. I think my third one to run with the list would probably be Mario 3. Not because it's the greatest soundtrack of all time, but because it's just so iconic and just always in my head. So...
Yeah.
Those are my three. Transistor, Witcher 3, Mario 3.
Okay.
And then from our other Patreon supporter, Ted, he says, what are one or two things in video games that annoy the crap out of you or genuinely find no joy in? I'm going to go with the number one thing that drives me nuts is movement speed when it's too slow. It really bothers me when you can't speed up the movement speed.
I can see that.
So annoying. Like, I want to get somewhere. Like, I was really excited when I was playing Dragon Quest XI. I thought that the combat was a little too slow for me.
Yeah.
But in the options, you can speed it up. So I was happy to do that. So it went faster. Like, it's not like the 3x speed like a Final Fantasy VII remake or whatever it is, port or anything like that. But it is in the game just to speed up the combat.
So a thing that bugs me, and this is actually probably my only nitpick about Fire Emblem,
mm-hmm.
is the menus aren't consistent.
Oh, really?
So, or what buttons do what on what mm-hmm. menu is right. inconsistent between menus. So, like, the one that always gets me is go into battalions, and to, like, refresh your battalions isn't pressing A to confirm, it's hitting the plus button.
Huh.
It's the only menu that does this. That's only menu in the entire game that does it. It's just completely different than the other menus. The gardening one gets me, too, because whenever you're selecting seeds to plant, it's not have the seed selected plus A. It's left and right on the stick to put it into the garden. And then A confirms what you're planting in total.
Right.
And I always mess it up. Like, it, and I think that's my only thing, is it's clear that the menus weren't, to me as a developer, I look at it, it doesn't seem like the menus were worked on by the same person or the same team. They were worked on by each feature.
Right.
And they did their best to work it back together, but there wasn't a unified vision of, okay, a menu works like this. And so that is a thing that gets under my skin when playing games, whenever there's inconsistency of control and user interface.
God, I wonder if that's a function of, I was going to say rushing to market, but they delayed that several times. Just an oversight.
Oversight, I'm almost certain of it. And I'm sure it was like, oh, we would love to do this, but we really don't. There's more important things to do than rework the interface on this for this menu.
Right.
It never bubbles up to the surface, typically. That's one that bugs me.
Those are two good answers.
Yeah, I'm sure there's plenty of other stuff that bugs me.
Yeah, loot boxes, EA. EA.
Hey, EA got me my house, so what can I say?
Yeah, you're a sellout. That's what we can say.
I am a sellout, and I have a house that I'm very happy with because of that sellout. No. And I can't even say I hate loot boxes. They can just be executed very poorly.
Yeah, I think for me it's just the greed that drives decisions as opposed to letting the art or the creativity drive decisions for games. So
still a business.
I know.
Still gotta make money.
They're making tons of money, so whatever.
Unless you wanna be the poor starving indie artist, which can happen, which is fine.
Yeah, it's easy to be on the outside, you know, you fucking sell up a fan of some like big fucking the big three or big five publishing companies said, I want to give you $10 million to publish your manuscript right now. I'd be like, fuck yeah, here you go.
Hell yeah, let's do this.
Whatever you want.
I don't care. Do I have to give any approval? No, don't even ask me. Don't care. Yep.
Just do whatever
you
want.
Depositing that check and bye. Never talk to me again.
I'm down for that.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, that has been Prof and Dev Play Games, episode 206. He is at SummerSpeak. I am at Prof Plays Games. If you like our show, please tell six of your friends and have them subscribe. And then check us out on Patreon. Just search Prof and Dev Play Games. We'll be back next week where we will be talking about something great. We're
probably
getting into
my time
the fall.
At PAX.
Your time at PAX. There we go. That's going to be pretty awesome.
Yeah.
And thanks
Cyberpunk
for listening.
Is not there.
Really?
Nope. They said that they won't be showing up. They originally were. They said they were gonna have some of them there to do a presentation and do the demo live at PAX. But then they, during Gamescom, said, no, we're not actually going to go. I think it was mostly, oh my God, why would we do that to ourselves? Like, finish one convention and then fly to Seattle for another one? Yeah, no.
Right. Well, they said they're releasing that behind closed door demo, but they're like
during PAX,
15 minutes of it or something like that.
It's like a 15 minute, but it's 15 minutes. It's basically they're going to live stream what they do behind closed doors at Gamescom.
Oh, okay. Or we're at PAX? And no, not PAX. Sorry, Gamescom.
During PAX, they're going to do the live stream.
Got it.
So anyone can just log into Twitch and watch the presentation, and they'll put the video up on YouTube. So, yep, everyone will get to see it.
Yeah, cool. Oh, man, good times. Yeah. I hope you have a fun time at PAX. That's going to be great. Yeah. All right, man. Well, thanks for episode 206, and we'll see you all next week. Thanks for listening.
All right, take it easy.